I will say welcome, and I'm Betsy Rose, and just going to offer a little bit of opening music to bring ourselves into the circle and begin to settle. It's really good to see all of you on Zoom. I see familiar names and faces. So here's a little invitation from Rumi and Lynn Unger, through me to you. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again come. And feel free to sing along with any of this as long as you are muted. That would be wonderful. Let's sing it again. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come. Yet again, come, let's come together. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again, come. Yet again, year after year, here we are gathered normally at Livermore, today gathered from all parts onto Zoom and Livermore and everywhere, and thank heavens we're all together again. This song I think you all know, and it's a beautiful, comes from the Welsh tradition, from Ellen Farjan, who actually I found out wrote one of my very favorite children's stories that I never knew it was her. It moves me very much that as a young child I met this woman who wrote Morning Has Broken. So, morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rains, new fall, sunlit from heaven. Sweet the rains, new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning. Born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise it. Oh, thank you. Cat Stevens, whose Muslim name I'm sorry I don't remember right now, and Ellen Farjan. Isn't it beautiful? A musical collaboration across generations and countries and faiths. Quite wonderful. So we're going to do one more for now. And I forgot to mention that if you'd like to see the lyrics to any of these songs so you can sing along more easily, they are posted on the EPI website where you got the link for this event. So feel free if you want to. Most of them, you either know them or they're very easy. Our last song is one that I think many of you are familiar with, and it's by Rabbi Shlomo Carlbach, Return Again. And I love singing this song for so many reasons, but right now because it feels so often that we are trying here to call to their senses people who have enormous power, way too much power, way too little spiritual resource, are influenced by factors that are not leading them in the right direction. So we ask them to return again to the land of their soul. The words are very simply, return again to the land of your soul. That's the first part. Return again, return again, return to the land of your soul. Sing that with me. Return again, return again, return to the land of who you are, return to what you are, return to where you are, born and reborn again. Return again, return again, return to what you are, return to where you are, born and reborn again. And one last time. Return again, return again, return to my friends, for gathering in peace with warm hearts, wise hearts, loving hearts. And I want to welcome now Janet Cordes Gibson, to welcome us all more fully. Hi, Janet. Janet, you need to unmute.
There we did. I just thank you. Let me get, so good morning, everybody. to all of our friends who share a vision of peace and justice, I welcome you to this Good Friday service. My name is Janet Cordes Gibson, and on behalf of the Ecumenical Peace Institute of Northern California, I welcome you to our 39th annual worship and witness at Livermore Nuclear Weapons Lab. For the third year, our service will be a virtual Zoom, which will be recorded so that you can share it again and again. Just check our website. It will be made more perfectly as the days go on. Now, let me just give you a little background about EPI. We go back to the late 1960s. That's when we began. It was the time of the Vietnam War, and the great leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., gave a speech at New York's Riverside Church, calling on the world to work actively and nonviolently to oppose the three evils of racism, materialism, and militarism. In the following years, EPI was formed in Berkeley, California. And later, Clergy and Laity Concern formed as a national organization, and we also joined that. EPI's mission has been to answer the need of change and for change and changing systems worldwide, which can create and perpetuate, these systems are creating and perpetuating misery for many people around our world. We welcome and encourage all of you to join this movement wherever you live and wherever you can participate. And to help build communities of justice, both locally and worldwide. So now I will turn the meeting over and our program will begin. Have a wonderful Good Friday. Thank you.
Next, we have an honoring of the land and the ancestors by Isabella Zizi.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me well? Can I get a few waves?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, wonderful. Hello, my name is Isabella Zizi. I come from the Northern Cheyenne, Arikara, and Muscogee Creek tribes. I'm a member of I Don't Know More SFA, and I'm a signatory on the Indigenous Women of the Americas Defending Mother Earth Treaty. I'm very honored and blessed to be here in the physical presence and be here virtually with you all on this beautiful day. And I just wanted to offer a few words of acknowledgement to the original people of the lands that we're occupying here today, and want you all to also hold space for wherever you are in your home. Oops, I'm echoing. Wherever you are in your home, and if you wouldn't mind just closing your eyes with me. Taking a few deep breaths. Feeling the roots and the bottom of your feet connecting to our beautiful Mother Earth. And just giving gratitude here to the Ohlone people, to the Confederated Village of the Lausanne, the original stewards of this land who cared for our trees, the soil, the water, our non-human relatives, the four-legged, the winged, those who fly above us and those who swim alongside us. And we pay acknowledgement to those who have passed on, and those who are present, and those who are yet to come, to ensure a safe and beautiful and vibrant future so that we may all live in balance and harmony with our beautiful Mother Earth, be in balance with one another as humankind, and that we will continue to help open the eyes and open the hearts for those who have a veil covering their eyes and covering their hearts and their spirits. To be connected once again. And I just wanted to offer a sweet song. I'm just gonna sing one verse, and I'm just gonna look it up real quick on who on who sings it. So it's called Mother, I Feel You Under My Feet, and it's a song by Wind Spirit Drum. Mother, I feel you under my feet. Mother, I hear your heartbeat. Mother, I feel you under my feet. Mother, I hear your heartbeat. Hey, 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 hey. Wendo, thank you for having me here. It's such a blessing. You all fill my heart with so much gratitude.
Next, we have an invocation by Farha Andrabi Navaid.
Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be with you all. Assalamu alaikum. God Almighty, who is known by many names. You are all bountiful, the all-knowing, the all-wise, and the most merciful. You are the creator of the earth and the heavens and all that exists in between. You created the oceans, lands, plants, animals, and all creation, and you honored humans to be your Khalifa, your representative on earth, so we may establish your order, and through it establish peace for all of your creation. God, forgive us. Forgive us, for we have erred. We have erred by forgetting our place as your stewards on earth. We have contributed to contaminating the waters, killing the fish. We have uprooted the plants and destroyed the wildlife. We have cut the mountains and polluted the air. And though you dignified all humanity by saying, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ, indeed, I have dignified all children of Adam, we reduced human stature by spreading hate, bigotry, and prejudices. We have erred by allowing exploitation of the weak and by benefiting the rich and the powerful. We succumbed to greed, envy, arrogance, hate and aggression, and we succumbed to falsehood. We indulged in wars and we continue to invent and amass weapons of mass destruction. God Almighty, we err not by never being sensitive and never showing compassion, but we err by being sensitive and compassionate selectively to serve our own interests and to serve only our own kind. Free our compassion, O Almighty God. Free our compassion and our sense of justice from tribalism, nationalism, religious bigotry, racism, and from all other forms of arrogance and ignorance and from heedlessness. Give us the courage to be not among those who witness oppression and injustice and do nothing. Inspire us to make a difference and to be your true representatives on earth. Inspire us to respect this earth and all that exists on it. Inspire us to recognize the equal dignity of all humans around the world. Help us realize that truth alone leads to justice and justice alone leads to real peace. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa warzuqna ittiba'ahu wa arina al-batila batil warzuqna ijtinabahu. Our Lord, reveal to us the truth as truth and give us the provisions to stand firmly on it, and grant us the ability to see falsehood as falsehood, and give us provisions to stay away from it. We ask you, O our Lord, to return us to your holy ways. Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabarakta wa ta'alayta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. God, you are the absolute peace, and all peace comes from you, and all paths of peace lead towards you. So fill our lives with peace and grant us entrance into the abode of peace. Blessed are you, O our Lord, O owner of majesty and honor. Thank you. Over to Betsy Rose for song, Holy Ground.
Thank you, Farha. Thank you so much. Another invocation to the land, honoring of the land, and the fact that we come and stand on this land in peace. If you have the lyrics, please sing along. May every step be holy. May we walk in peace. And may our hearts be open and all our fears released. May we stand for justice wherever suffering is found, and humbly walk together upon this holy ground. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. I'd like to sing that one more time. Hope you can join me. May every step be holy. May we walk in peace. May every step be holy. May we walk in peace. May all our hearts be open and all our fears released. May all our hearts be open and all our fears released. May we stand for justice wherever suffering is found. May we stand for justice wherever suffering is found, and humbly walk together upon this holy ground, and humbly walk together upon this holy ground. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. Thank you. And now we're going to welcome, I think I've got this right. Yes, Marilia Kelly for a nuclear update.
Good morning. I'm Mary Leah Kelly, as you just heard, the executive director of Tri-Valley Cares, which stands for Communities Against a Radioactive Environment. Tri-Valley Cares acts to change U.S. policy by stopping the further development of nuclear weapons and working tirelessly for their elimination. Tri-Valley Cares also addresses the environmental and health harms of nuclear development at Livermore and beyond. So let me say a few words about Livermore Lab, which is my job as part of this program. I am at the west gate of Livermore Lab. You will occasionally hear cars and some trucks. I can see scientists, engineers, and support personnel coming to work. Many will spend today, Good Friday, creating new weapons of nuclear mass destruction. Livermore Lab is one of two locations in the United States that designs every nuclear warhead and bomb in the US arsenal. The other is Los Alamos Lab in New Mexico. Livermore Lab is owned by the US Department of Energy's National Nuclear Security Administration. The lab is operated by a consortium of contractors, including Bechdel Corporation and the University of California, which has managed Livermore Lab since it was founded in 1952. On this Good Friday, my friends, we must confront that the Biden administration request for fiscal year 2023, the coming fiscal year, is the largest military request in US history. President Biden requests more than $813 billion. $813 billion. for national defense, which means the Pentagon and the Department of Energy nuclear weapons activities, including those that go on here at Livermore Lab. Livermore Lab's most recent budget that we have, and the government is trickling out the details, let me tell you, but more than 80% of that budget is for nuclear weapons activities. That's the name of the budget line. A tiny, tiny, tiny amount, less than 2%, is allocated for science that isn't nuclear weapons related. And there's a tiny sliver, around 1%, for energy efficiency and renewable energy resources. So understand why it is important that we focus on Good Friday, on nuclear weapons, and specifically on the Livermore Lab's nuclear weapons activities. So when I speak about what goes on inside this classified fence line, it's fitting to start with Livermore Lab's central role in driving a new and dangerous global arms race. As we speak, and with our hearts full, with the war in Ukraine and the Russian nuclear saber rattling, the United States nuclear weapons budget throws fuel on the fire of potential nuclear war, rather than charting a path away from it, charting a path toward justice, towards peace, and towards global security and the elimination of nuclear weapons. Instead, we're there with a huge gasoline can full of money, adding fuel to the fire. I'll focus my brief remarks today on two warheads that Livermore Lab is developing. But please know, there are more than two. Of that $813 billion, about $30 billion for the Department of Energy nuclear weapons programs and related programs, and Livermore Lab's budget, when we get the details, is likely to be more than $2 billion or around $2 billion of that. Some of you have heard me speak on Good Friday about the Livermore Lab is developing expressly for a sneak nuclear attack on an unsuspecting population anywhere in the world. This warhead is for what's called the long-range standoff weapon. It is intended for pilots to be able to stand off a target thousands of miles away and launch a precisely guided radar-evading nuclear weapon. By any measure, Livermore's new warhead for the long-range standoff capability is an offensive first-use weapon. And I mean both meanings of that word offensive, by the way. It's immoral. The government is spending billions of dollars on this warhead called the W80-4. And Livermore Lab, when it finishes the development of the W80-4 for the long-range standoff weapon, Livermore Lab has plans to modify that warhead so that it can go on a new sea-launched cruise missile, to go on small attack submarines that today do not have any nuclear weapons on them. All nuclear weapons are immoral, but I want you to understand that the United States and Livermore Lab specifically are developing nuclear weapons that blur the distinction between conventional capabilities and nuclear weapons, so that a potential opponent or target or whatever horrible word you want to use for that sees a weapon being launched. They will not know if it's conventional or nuclear. It looks the same coming toward them. And this is particularly dangerous in terms of what might trigger nuclear annihilation for all of us. The second warhead I want to highlight today is called the W87-1. It's in an earlier stage of development than the W80-4, And the W87-1 is the first, it's going to go on land-based missiles, and it is the first wholly new, completely new nuclear warhead since the announced end of the Cold War nearly 40 years ago. The W87-1 that Livermore is developing right now today, Good Friday, is planning to have a lot of new technologies and new capabilities. One in particular, in fact, 126 of them, according to the Government Accountability Office. This includes a new design plutonium bomb core. And this warhead that Livermore is developing is the driver for the United States plan to increase plutonium pit, or it's called a pit, bomb core production, the plutonium core inside nuclear weapons. The United States is poised to spend scores of billions of dollars making new pits for new warheads. And if you look at the fiscal year 2023 parts of the budget that have been released, the request for plutonium, the budget line that funds plutonium bomb cores, is up 60%. We are at an inflection point. We need to change this course. Separately, the Pentagon is developing a new missile for this new warhead to be on top of. This so-called modernization program overall, when you look at all of the different nuclear warheads, bombs and delivery systems, is slated to cost about $2 trillion. It's hard to imagine $2 trillion over the next 30 years. Occasionally, you'll hear politicians talking that the United States doesn't have enough money for civilian infrastructure, the United States doesn't have enough money for healthcare, the United States doesn't have enough money to continue to fund pandemic readiness for this pandemic that hasn't ended and the next one that may come. When you hear this, please, please think about that $2 trillion for infrastructure and new bombs and warheads. That's what the United States is buying with our tax dollars with very little discussion. On this Good Friday, I wanna specifically say a few more words about what is being sacrificed by the nuclear weapons work, specifically here at Livermore Lab. Our environment and our health have been sacrificed in the name of nuclear weapons development here in the Bay Area, in Livermore, in Tracy, where Livermore Lab has a high explosive testing range just outside of town, and truly at all the other nuclear weapons sites around the world. But speaking of Livermore, Tri-Valley Cares has documented from lab documents that more than 1 million curies of radiation have been released into the air. This is just in the air. There's some that's gone into the soil and other leaks too, but in the air, 1 million curies. What's 1 million curies? According to documents, this is equal to the radiation deposited on the people of Hiroshima. It's been dribbled out of the stacks on these buildings over many years, and not all at once in a flash of blinding heat. Nonetheless, we too, here in the Bay Area and in Tracy and on the cusp of the Central Valley, we are its victims. Livermore Lab employees have experienced high levels of cancers and other illnesses stemming from toxic and radioactive exposures on the job. Nearly 3,000 current and former Livermore Lab workers or their survivors have applied for federal compensation due to illnesses related to on-the-job exposures. And Tri-Valley Care staff attorney helps them with the hurdles of applying and getting compensation. Additionally, past epidemiological studies have shown that children who are born in or who are moved to Livermore have experienced more cancers than other similar children elsewhere. And cancer is just one negative health outcome from radiation and toxic exposures. There are others. The soils and the groundwater aquifer here where I am at the Livermore Lab main site and at the lab site 300 high explosive testing range near Tracy have both been polluted by nuclear weapons activities. In fact, both the Livermore Lab main site and site 300 are on the EPA's Superfund list of most polluted sites in the nation. What can we do today? I'm going to say 15 words, I believe. Act for nuclear weapons abolition. Act for nuclear weapons abolition. Act for nuclear weapons abolition. There are opportunities to change US policy. I invite you to participate in them in whatever creative, nonviolent ways you feel moved to do. The only creative, nonviolent action that's wrong is one you don't do. Tri-Valley Cares will have more information on its website. We are part of a national group of peace and justice and environmental groups across the country and around the world who are acting to lift up the Treaty on the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons as one way to reach the total elimination globally. We are pushing our government. We are pushing other governments, but we are especially pushing our government. I invite you to be part of that effort in whatever way you choose. And I invite you to keep on. Our religious peace community has been faithful, if I might use that word. And for that, from the bottom of my heart, I thank you. And I hope I'm encouraging you to keep on with the next step. And I move our program to our next. And Betsy Rose will sing some more. Yay, Betsy. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Mary Lee. I'm sorry I garbled your name earlier. Oh, my goodness. Okay, let me. Okay. Sorry. In response to what you've just shared with us, and it's hard to be the bearer of such truth, and grateful to you for laying out what, in a way, no one wants to hear and everyone needs to hear, so thank you very much. The great Arundhati Roy, peacemaker, land activist, champion of poor people in India, has a quote that has been with me ever since I first heard it. She says, not only is a new world is not only possible, it is on its way. On a still day, I can hear her breathing. There's a new world coming. There's a new world coming. There's a new world coming. I can hear her breathing. I can hear her breathing. Sing with me, new world. There's a new world coming. There's a new world coming. There's a new world coming. I can hear her breathing. Two breaths in, long breath out. I can hear her breathing. Breathing in. That breathing happens to be the breathing that midwives offer to birthing people in labor. It is the breathing of birth. Two breaths in, one long breath out. So let us give birth to that new world. Are you ready for that green morning? Are you ready? ready for that clear light? Are you ready to work together? Sing through every long dark night. There's a new world. There's a new world coming. Let's sing it. There's a response to "Are you ready?" is yes, we are ready for that great morning. Sing at least the yes, if nothing else. Yes, we are ready for that great morning. We are ready, yes, for that clear light. We are ready, yes, to work together. Sing through every long dark night. There's a new world coming, yes. There's a new world coming. There's a new world coming. I can hear her breathing. Yes, breathe with me. I can hear her breathing. I can hear her breathing. Yes. Thank you. And I want to welcome Carl Anderson to speak to us.
I've been here dozens of times for Good Friday. Recent events in Ukraine and elsewhere have led me to ask my friends, the planners of this gathering, to add a few minutes to our order of worship to express my thoughts. What happened to Ukraine in February was a severely violent escalation, invasion. I recall another severely violent escalation, which occurred in 2003, Iraq. Such escalations caused heavy loss of life and millions of refugees. Old hatreds get worse and new hatreds arise. Further escalations are a serious risk. They happened within Iraq and within Syria. And after a bit, I will say something about an even worse kind of escalation. Nonviolence also happens. Remember the US in 2003. We protested nonviolently against the invasion of Iraq. We did so in large numbers. We didn't stop the invasion. To that extent, we lost. But our protests of 2003 laid some groundwork for eventual peace. There's a parallel in Russia. Many Russians have said, "Нет войне," no to war, using nonviolent methods. The Russian government responded with 15,000 arrests since the invasion. In the short term, the no to war Russians are losing, but they are laying groundwork for eventual reconciliation of Russians and Ukrainians. I'm a Quaker. Here are some words from a Russian Quaker written on the day of the invasion. Each of us is called to come to an understanding of the pain of war, of the malignancy of the developing situation. And God will give each of us the strength to make a stand and to speak out as long as we listen to the song of peace. Act according to your conscience. Do not allow the circumstances to destroy you. Hold to those you hold dear. Help those near to you. Make a public witness for peace. Don't give an ear to the blandishments of the propagandists. No to war, Boris Fedyukin. More about escalation. I'm speaking from just outside Livermore Lab, just the other side of the fence. Many times, Mary Leah Kelly, Daniel Ellsberg, and others have reminded us of the lab's main purpose. Here's a way to describe that main purpose: to enable nuclear escalation. Enable nuclear escalation. And that kind of escalation would be far worse. So we work for peace. We do what we can. We remind ourselves that others who we don't even know about, also work for peace. Next, we have sacred dance with Ukraine in mind.
For the
go on. Somebody tell us, Mark.
Shall beat, right. And they shall beat, shall beat, and they shall beat, shall beat, and they shall beat.
In the wasteland of war, the expenditure of resources knows no restraints. Here, our abundance is fully recognized and enthusiastically squandered.
A king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength. The war horse is a vain hope for victory, and by its great might, it cannot save.
We still have a choice today. Nonviolent coexistence or violent coannihilation.
Racism and its perennial ally, economic exploitation, provide the key to understanding most of the international complications of this generation.
God Almighty and Glorious says, O my servants, I have forbidden oppression for myself and have made it forbidden among you, so do not oppress one another.
We still have a choice today. Nonviolent coexistence or violent coannihilation.
The large power blocks talk passionately of pursuing peace while expanding defense budgets that already bulge, enlarging already awesome armies, and devising ever more devastating weapons. The heads of all the nations issue clarion calls for peace, yet they come to the peace table accompanied by bands or brigades, each bearing unsheathed swords.
Then Jesus said to Peter, put your sword back in its place, for all who take the sword will die by the sword.
We still have a choice today. Nonviolent coexistence or violent coannihilation.
Before it is too late, we must narrow the gaping chasm between our proclamations of peace and our lowly deeds, which precipitate and perpetuate war. True nonviolence is more than the absence of violence. It is the persistent and determined application of peaceable power to offenses against the community. In this case, the world community.
However many holy words you read, however many you speak, what good will they do if you do not act upon them?
We still have a choice today. Nonviolent coexistence or violent coannihilation.
A genuine revolution of values means in the final analysis that our loyalties must become ecumenical rather than sectional. Every nation must now develop an overriding loyalty to humankind as a whole to preserve the best in their individual societies. This call for a worldwide fellowship that lifts neighborly concern beyond one's tribe, race, class, and nation is in reality a call for an all-embracing and unconditional love for all people.
There are horses of many colors, brown, black, yellow, white. Yet it is all one horse. So cattle, so all living things, animals, flowers, trees, so people. In this land where once only Indians are now humanity of every color, white, black, yellow, red, yet all one people. That this should come to pass was in the heart of the great mystery. It is right thus. And everywhere there shall be
nonviolent coexistence or violent coannihilation.
We must move past indecision to action.
We must find new ways to speak for peace and justice throughout the world. A world that is ours.
And if we do not act, we shall surely be dragged along dark and shaped out of fashion. Now let us begin ourselves in the long and bitter but beautiful struggle for a new world.
Soledad sobre ruinas, sangre en el trigo, rojo y amarillo. Manantial del veneno, escudo heridas, cinco siglos igual. Libertad sin galope, banderas rotas, soberbia y mentiras. Medallas de oro y plata, contra esperanza, cinco siglos igual. En esta parte de la tierra, la historia se cayó. Como se caen las piedras, aun las que tocan el cielo. Y están cerca del sol, o están cerca del sol. Lealtad sobre tumbas, piedra sagrada. Dios no alcanzó a llorar. Sueño largo del mal, infancias pobres, cinco siglos igual. Muerte contra la vida, gloria de un pueblo desaparecido. Es comienzo, es final. Leyenda perdida, cinco siglos igual. En esta parte de la tierra, la historia se cayó. Como se caen las piedras, aun las que tocan el cielo, o están cerca del sol. Pues tan cerca del sol, es tiniebla con flores, revoluciones, y aunque muchos no están, nunca nadie pensó besarte los pies, cinco siglos igual. Gracias.
Good morning. My name is Father Ivan Tao. I'm the pastor of Newman Hall Holy Spirit Parish. And I've been asked to read the Passion from Luke. And so it's just an honor to be here on this Good Friday morning, just a special day, especially for those of the Christian faith. As I proclaim the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, just in the midst of his horror and violence to him, I ask you to notice how Jesus is the model of nonviolence and compassion. And I ask you to reflect, how can we tap into that peace, that nonviolence in our world that's oppressed by violence, anger, and fear? You know, we see it in the Ukraine, Yemen, Ethiopia. We see it locally, Brooklyn, Sacramento, our freeways, and in our defense industry. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country. After laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children, for indeed the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' At that time, people will say to the mountains, 'Fall upon us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Now, two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right and the other on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they do." They divided his garments by casting lots. The people stood by and watched, and rulers meanwhile sneered at him and said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the chosen one, the Messiah of God." Even the soldiers jeered at him. As they approached to offer him wine, they called out, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." Above him, there was an inscription that read, "This is the King of the Jews." Now, one of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply, "Have you no fear of God? For you are subject to the same condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we receive corresponds to our crimes, but this man has done nothing criminal." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied to him, "Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said, "This man was innocent beyond doubt." When all the people who had gathered for this spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the women who had followed him from Galilee and saw these events. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you, Father Ivan. Next, we have a homily from Reverend Allison Tanner.
Let me get first of all, let me say thank you to all who have already spoken and sung and prayed. Your words have stirred me, and thank you to all who have organized and brought about this gathering. I want to begin with a brief confession of faith fitting to this moment. I believe in peace, and I've committed my life to the ways that make for peace. I believe that there can be no real peace with the existence of nuclear weapons. As a follower of Jesus, I must take seriously the command to love my enemies, and we cannot wage war or threaten nuclear annihilation against those we love. Nor can we promote the existence of weapons that kill billions and destroy the earth that gives us life. As a follower of Jesus, I must take seriously the command to love my neighbors. And we cannot pour resources into expanding nuclear arsenals at the expense of the impoverished in our community. With so many of our neighbors in need of homes, jobs, safety, decent education and opportunity for their families, we cannot love our neighbors and also support warmongers and war profiteers at their expense. If you believe in peace, if you have committed your life to the ways that make for peace, then you know that there can be no real peace alongside the threat of nuclear weapons. And now a confession. A personal confession from some of the early years of my marriage. It was slightly post the honeymoon stage and reality was setting in. And it turns out that my beloved had a great twisted desire to tease me and push my buttons. And he would do this rather frequently. And of course, the more it irked me, the more it inspired him. And so to my horror, I frequently found that a very successful way of shutting his up was whacking him on side the head. And when I would do that, I would do that with great emotion to send a very clear, strong message. I don't want you to do this. And you might say that it was effective because he stopped, but only for 30 minutes. In fact, I would argue that it actually inspired him to continue escalating his teasing. My actions of violence, even in a playful way, did not stop the outcome that I wanted it to stop. And ultimately, it did not make me feel better because I walked around feeling guilty that I had in me this great passion that I couldn't control and it would explode. It didn't bring us closer together. It didn't bring us toward healing or a stronger relationship. In fact, it created a wedge between us. And I share this story, this silly example, to remind us that unless we can learn to live peacefully with our loved ones, which does take practice, and unless we can learn to live peacefully with our neighbors, which does take patience, and unless we can learn somehow to live peacefully with our many, with our enemies, which takes serious, prayerful intention, we cannot demand the same of others. Peace is not only our goal, it is our means to our goal. And the foundation of peace is justice. The force of peace is love. If we want peace at our goal, it must also be the means through which we get there. Let's apply the same logic to much larger concerns in humanity, especially in light of very real world tyrants with great power and propensity to destroy. Carl, you mentioned Ukraine, and it's important today to acknowledge what's happening in Ukraine. Ukraine is yet another manifestation of expanding empire that is seeking to destroy yet another people, yet another community and culture and land. And the news is filled with the horrors of war, its devastation, its death, mass graves, people fleeing their homes, bodies left in the streets. And it can be tempting, and indeed I've heard even from loved ones in my circles, Ukraine is the very reason why we must have nuclear weapons. We need them as a deterrent from the bullies. But glorification of war to keep our enemies at bay is not the answer. Peace is not just our goal, it must be our means. The threat of nuclear power will not solve the problems of this world. If we are committed to peace with justice, we must find humane ways to hold tyrants accountable, to hold warmongers accountable, ways to hold people accountable without destroying our own humanity, let alone our environment, our world in the process. I have a friend who used to be a diplomat to the Ukraine. She's currently a legal scholar there. And she's come and done presentations on the harsh realities that are on the ground. And it is tear-inducing and it is stomach-churning. But as she talks with passion about the tireless hours that she has spent trying to get her friends to safety, she also shares the courage of the people who are currently on the ground in Ukraine. People who are currently living under siege, under constant bomb attacks, who are looking death in the face and continuing to believe in the ways of peace. she talks about her Ukrainian friends who are very clear that they long for liberation, but their liberation will not come until Russians too have been liberated. For a country that engaged in nuclear disarmament and is now under threat of weapons of mass destruction, the people she knows continue to hope for peace, to believe in peace, and to fight for peace. And she tells us that we who are far away must not have less hope for peace than the people who are living under bombs. We must follow their example. We must do our work, our hope, our commitment to be people who follow the ways of peace. I don't know many Ukrainians. Personally, I know Palestinians. And I carry with me a bracelet from the last time I was in Bethlehem, a bracelet that I purchased at the Aida refugee camp, which happens to be the place where the most tear gas canisters fall in the world. Tear gas canisters made in the United States, made from our tax dollars. And yet the Palestinians that I know, those who hope and work for peace, those who insist on nonviolence, take the tear gas canisters and mold them into something beautiful. And it is a sign of the hope that we must have. For let us not have less hope for peace than those living under occupation, settler colonial violence, strategic ethnic cleansing. As Palestinians demand their freedom, their justice, their equality through nonviolent means, may we follow their commitments to demand peace and to work for justice. Today is a significant day. April 15th in the United States is synonymous with tax day. And I know my sister's a CPA and she insists that today isn't tax day, it's gonna be Monday. But still, it is April 15th. April 15th, tax day, calls us to ask the question, where are we putting our money, our resources, and our attention? In 2018, nearly $20 billion of our taxes were used to fund nuclear weapons. And I believe $813 billion is what's currently being invested in nuclear arsenals. What does Jesus have to say to this? Well, famously, Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar and give to God what is God's. But what Jesus was really saying is that the ways of empire, the ways of Caesar are not the ways of God. And we are to be following in the ways of God, not the ways of empire. Jesus was clear that there are bigger powers at play in the world than those of empire. And we are invited, we are beseeched to pour our true treasures in the way of peace and love and justice. And so we gather. We gather to say we can't fully control what happens to our tax dollars, but we can insist that it's wrong, and we can insist that we will give to God the deepest treasures that we have, and we will follow the ways of peace and justice and love as best we are able. Today is also Passover, the Jewish celebration of Pesach, which celebrates the freedom and liberation of oppressed people. To worship a God of freedom and a liberation is to work to bring about freedom to the oppressed and liberation to those who are enslaved. and those who are enslaved in their poverty long for and need freedom, and those enslaved to their riches may not long for it, but desperately need freedom. Today is also Good Friday. Good Friday, when Jesus was again clear that the ways of empire yield death, a death that he himself was subject to. But he was also clear that the ways of community yield life. We acknowledge today that innocent people continue to suffer and die at the hands of the sins of the world. And we are called to identify with those who suffer and work to end their mistreatment. And today that brings us here to Lawrence Livermore Nuclear Labs. I want to end my remarks by offering the prophetic words of Archbishop John Wester of Santa Fe, New Mexico. Many of you saw and have read his pastoral letter and his words, urging, demanding conversations toward nuclear disarmament, are so profound that Friday. And so indulge me as I read a few paragraphs of words that so desperately need to be heard in this place, throughout our country and throughout the world. Archbishop Wester says, we can no longer deny or ignore the dangerous predicament that we have created for ourselves. We need to start talking about it with one another, all of us, and figure out concrete steps toward abolishing nuclear weapons and ending nuclear threat. If we care about humanity, if we care about our planet, if we care about, then we must start a public conversation on the urgent questions and find a new path toward nuclear disarmament. Convinced as I am, this is Archbishop Wester, convinced that I am that a world without nuclear weapons is possible and necessary, I ask political leaders not to forget that these weapons cannot protect us from current threats to national and international security. We need to ponder the catastrophic impact of their deployment, especially from a humanitarian and environmental standpoint, and reject heightening climates of fear, mistrust, and hostility, to commit ourselves globally to the complete abolition of nuclear weapons. We should end all these massive financial investments for building and maintaining these weapons of mass destruction, investments that make only a few individuals and corporations massive funds in education, healthcare, environmental cleanup, addressing the climate threat, rebuilding our infrastructure, and providing vaccines for everyone, everywhere, against future pandemics. This tax day, what does the Lord require of us? Let me just share a few ideas for action, adapted again from Archbishop Wester, and I hope they'll be shared in the chat as well, so you can follow up, join the dialogue. Talk about the presence of nuclear weapons in our community, with our family, with our friends, with our coworkers, with our congregation, with our book groups, with our exercise groups, with whoever you come in contact with. I invite you to read the power and share his letter to start a conversation on how we can work together for the abolition of nuclear weapons. I invite you to pray daily for the abolition of nuclear weapons and practice nonviolence in our own lives, with our loved ones, with our neighbors, with our enemies. I encourage you to express your support for the treaty of the prohibition of nuclear weapons, especially with your political representatives. And finally, if you have investments,
please use your money consciously. There's a link in the chat so that you can look up how to not invest in nuclear weapons. We must divest. We must abolish. These final words also come from Archbishop Wester, and I'll close with these. As we engage in conversations, he encourages us, all our conversations should be respectful, rooted in prayer, based in nonviolence, and centered in the hope and belief that nuclear disarmament is achievable. We can do this. And with the God of peace with us, we can do this soon. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Tanner. And now I would like to move us to the offering time. 76 years ago, the United States dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, immediately killing 120,000 people. Livermore is still developing nuclear weapons, as are many other countries. The need for your involvement and support to bring about world peace is crucial. This year, more than ever, as part of your participation in the peace movement, we welcome your financial support and for continuing work of the EPI and the Livermore Conversion Projects. Funds that are collected today will be shared equally with both groups. As we give thanks for future work, I want to share our appreciation for those who have provided critical support for our virtual event, not only today, but for the past 2 years. The quality of these virtual experiences has primarily been due to support from St. John's Presbyterian Church in Berkeley. We thank them. We thank Greg Rising for his technical skills. We thank Mark Copeland for his organizational talent. And we thank Pastor Max Lynn for his active support of our cause. And with that, I would like to let us go on, and there's going to be some music played for a minute or so by Tony Scar, as you think about what you would like to share. And by the way, there will be some signs up at the end of this for you to get more information, but you can go to our website for all the information on how to get tax deductible checks sent to EPI for this. So thank you, and Tony, there you go.
Thank you.
believe we have the office prays over, and we have
next, Sylvia Perez.
Oh, okay, Sylvia's. As we wait for Sylvia.
I'm ready.
Are you ready? Okay, hang on after it's over because we have some more announcements.
So there is a message in the Gita, in the Bhagavad Gita, to Arjuna as he grieves for those about to die in battle. Worn out garments are shed by the body. Worn out bodies are shed by the dweller within the body. New bodies are donned by the dweller like garments, not wounded by weapons, not burned by fire, not dried by the wind, not wetted by water. Such is the Atman, not dried, not wetted, not burned, not wounded, innermost element everywhere, always, being of beings, changeless, eternal, forever and ever. We must remember today that on the cross is the planet. On the cross is the beauty of the earth, our mother. On the cross is every human being and every animal and every flower and every blossom, and call on everybody to give up this love, this addiction to war on all sides. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Yo no canto por cantar, ni por tener buena voz. Canto porque la guitarra tiene sentido y razón. Tiene corazón de tierra y alas de palomita. Es como el agua bendita, santigua glorias y pena. Aquí se encajó mi canto, como dijera Violeta. Guitarra trabajadora, con ola la primavera. Que no es guitarra de ricos, ni cosa que se parezca. Mi canto es de los andamios para alcanzar las estrellas. El canto tiene sentido cuando palpita en las venas del que morirá cantando las verdades verdaderas. No las lisonjas fugaces
milas formas extranjeras, sino que el canto de una lonja hasta el fondo de la tierra. Aquí donde llega todo y donde todo comienza, canto que ha sido valiente, siempre será canción nueva, siempre será canción nueva, siempre será canción nueva.
So now we're back here at the lab, and we were going to bring a missile out here from Western States Legal Foundation's evidence locker. And Jackie says to Carl, "Carl, you can't break the chain of custody. Leave the missile in the locker." So we just brought the money. But we want to talk about taxes. What if we got to decide where our taxes went? You know, what if I said, I don't want all of my taxes to go to the government, to weapons, to whatever. I want some money to go to housing. So I took a bundle of money out of that missile, and we're putting it to housing. And what about childcare? Now, I know you're going to hear a bunch of things here that were in the big Build Back Better Act. So the government can do these things. They just need to have the will that we have. So child care. Another bag of money for child care. We got to do this.
Put our money where our priorities are.
Then after, exactly, we have our own priorities. Like education. Let's take a fistful of dollars for education. We'll give it to the schools.
Yeah.
I think we did housing. There's something is so critical. Healthcare. How about some money to healthcare? Let's give another bundle of money to healthcare. We got lots of money.
Yeah.
And full disclosure, all of these monopoly dollars took illegitimate monopoly games out of thrift stores in our community and out of the hands of children who would be lied to by this game. Anyway, redirecting our money to the things that we want. There could even be a block that you check that says, I want 50% of my money to go to healthcare, 25% to go to schools, and 25% to go to housing for the poor. Really good things. And the fact is, we're talking about billions of dollars. So there's plenty of money to go around. There's no issue about this. But before I conclude, I wanted to hit one point, maybe some money for humanity. Last week or the week before, a couple of Ukrainians coming into the country asking for asylum were then transported to the next stage of their quest in handcuffs and shackles. Well, of course, the outrage, people were stunned because these white people were put in cuffs and manacles. Well, you know that, by the way, that's the protocol in the United States. Nobody is transported looking for asylum without manacles, chains on their legs, handcuffs on their wrists. Even the people that are being taken to Russia right now from Ukraine are not going in chains. That's what we should be outraged about. We should be aghast at just the thought that anybody coming for help in this country are immediately shocked when they're turned into prisoner status. Change the protocol
Hear, hear.
Biden, Harris, whatever, period. And our dollars, which we pay significantly, and I got no issue with that. I just want to decide where they go in a perfect world. Thank you for your time.
Hear, hear.
Monopoly dollars are what we should be giving the military. And I say that as a vet.
Next, we have a song from Betsy Rose.
I want to thank all of the speakers and readers and prayers and just this incredible creation that happens every year. It's so renewing. Thank you so much. We're going to close musically with the second half of Holy Ground. We started much earlier on, inviting us all to step into a place of sacred space, sacred land, sacred connection to the land and to each other. This is the second part, the benediction of the song. May every step be holy. May we live in peace. May every step be holy. May we live in peace. And may our hearts be open to everyone we meet. May we walk in beauty, reach out our hands to all around. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. As we go forth together upon this holy ground. I'd love it if those who are willing can sing along and remain muted, of course, sadly, but a wonderful way to end together. May every step be holy. May we live in peace. May every step be holy. May we live in peace. And may our hearts be open to everyone we meet. To everyone we meet. May we walk in beauty, reach out our hands to all around. May we walk in beauty, reach out our hands to all around. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. May every step be holy, for this is holy ground. As we go forth together, this holy ground, which is every step on every ground we walk on, wherever we are, as we go forth. As we go forth together upon this holy ground, as we go forth once more. As we go forth together upon this holy ground.
And now we have a benediction from Jim Haber.
Back here at Livermore, in front of the labs, I'm Jim Haber, and I was asked to offer up a benediction, a few words of a call to action. In part because of my Jewish faith, though I think I consider myself a Jewish pagan Catholic worker of sorts. I want to offer first, happy birthday, Mom. Today's my mom's birthday. But also Ramadan greetings, and Easter and Passover greetings, and BJ Prashad on Thursday in Bengal, I believe. So happy New Year to people there. I think I feel a little redundant after Carl's and Allison's prayers and remarks. I felt like they also were a call to action and a benediction. I hope that something I say touches you as well. I'm heartened by the hypocrisy that lurks in all of our hearts and can come out, and we need to be on guard of that, whether it's ourselves or our people, our nation, that we always be willing to challenge that. And I'm uplifted by the words in that regard constantly by Representative Ilhan Omar of Minnesota and locally of Zara Ballou of CARE San Francisco, the Council on American Islamic Relations, under attack for calling much in the same way for us to challenge the hypocrisies in our own faith communities. So let's challenge ourselves on our hypocrisies, and let's also renounce vengeance. And let's trust in that renunciation on the part of those we have hurt. For truly, as a Jew who's been to Palestine, I would say very few Palestinians want vengeance. They want justice. They want to be able to live. That's true of the Black community in the United States, hurt by years of racism, of every Native American community that I've been invited to be parts of, and any separatist movements, any lapse thereof, should not undo our belief in that quality of just wanting to live without a boot on our throats that people feel as they struggle for freedom. This call to action is a call to show up. And I want to say that even people who are running away are showing up. Survival counts. In harm reduction, we say you can't treat a dead addict. We need to survive. But we must stand strong and firm also. As we Jews celebrate Passover, then we enter the counting of the Omer, which is a cycle of 7 weeks of 7 days. 7 weeks takes us up to Shavuot, where we stood at Sinai to get the Torah from our God. And there's a tradition to read a certain passage of Pirkei Avot, Wisdom of the Parents, that we read throughout. And the second or third day, the teaching is one that I take to heart today for this benediction, because it's about showing up despite whatever we might feel or think. It's about showing up. You're not obligated to complete the task, but nor are you free to desist. So in these seemingly hopeless times, or times that challenge our hopefulness, I say we show up because we're alive, which brings to mind James Baldwin saying, when asked, are you an optimist? Or maybe it was phrased in the negative. And he said, I'm alive. I have to be an optimist. Sometimes we show up because we must. I declare my new t-shirt of an old slogan, I'm already against the next war. No longer just a protestation, but a twisted sort of sign of hope. Oh, we're going to survive this war. That's not a given to me now. And there are no cold wars. Every cold war is a hot war somewhere. I live here in the belly of the beast, and I might feel insulated and safe. And as we struggle, we need to find joy, but I'm never disconnected from the injustice and the imprisonment and the torture that's going on somewhere. We all share the same blue sky. We all share the same blue sky as my Afghan friends dedicate the blue scarf to remind us all we all share the same blue sky. As we are here and you're wherever you are, I want to connect to people vigiling at other friendly locations, or friends vigiling at other locations like Lockheed Martin's headquarters across the bay in Palo Alto today, at Vandenberg Air Force Base down the coast, at the Nevada test site with the Sacred Peace Walk. And my Good Friday activism, is it you, goes back to those days with Nevada Desert Experience and Peter Ettinger booming with his amazing voice. Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh. Good Friday means something to this Jew now. The pain, and yet we carry on because Good Friday is followed by Easter. And we all must remember to look up. We all must remember to look up, even as we looked within. And finally, just again, we all just need to keep showing up, even if we don't know what to do. My pagan group, the Reclaiming East Bay Community, we're just discussing the intention of our Beltane, our May Day ritual that's coming up. We're witches. It's Beltane. We dance the maypole. That's what we do. We're a community. We come together. We do what we must. Carry on. Act on despite whatever despair you may feel. You're not alone. We're not alone. Thank you. Blessed be.